is the final rebellion. There won't be any more. Jesus Christ is going to put a stop to that forever. He's given man 6,000 years to go his own way, and now he's going to take that 7,000 years, and he's going to show man how to make this earth into the most beautiful paradise you could ever even dream of. It's going to be that much of a wondrous sign. See, his coming is going to bring wonder and great and splendid results as soon as he arrives on this earth. That falling away is directly connected to the second coming. I mean, you have the falling away, and then right on the heels of that is the second coming of Jesus Christ. And I ask you, how many people, how many ministers do you hear discuss such a subject? Well, a lot of them will say, well, you can't know when Christ is going to come. No man knows the day or the hour. That's right. But Christ did say in that same context over in Matthew 24 that you'd better know when it's at the door. And it's at the door. It's at the door. I can guarantee you that by what the Bible says. Let's let the Bible interpret the Bible. But you have a man of sin or a son of destruction. He just moved in there and destroyed through God's truth to the ground. That's what he did inside God's church. That's a part of that sign that he did, this son of destruction. And even his soul arrogant and so satanic that he shows himself as being God. He's the ultimate authority. Now that's a kind of satanic madness to do something like that, but it happens, and it's inside God's church, and anybody who knows God surely would have to know that. How could they not know it? I mean, these are pretty dramatic prophecies when you think about it. And we need to understand, because never, ever did this world need a Savior more than it needs right now. Because if we don't have a Savior, then who's going to save us from ourselves and these weapons of mass destruction that keep proliferating all over this earth? Do we realize how dangerous this world is? And do we realize why Christ said He'd have to return and stop that, or there would be no human life left alive? Matthew 24, verses 21 and 22. The great falling away. You see, it started with Joshua and then into that son of perdition. One of Joshua's fellows then took over. But you see, you and I have to know God to know when this happens. How could we, you see, we have to know what God is doing and what God is saying and allowing this all to happen to teach us many wonderful lessons if we'll just heed what God says. A wondrous sign indeed. These men of sign have appeared already, so you can be sure that Christ's return is going to be imminent. Now, there is a book that explains a lot about this sign that I want to get into today as much as I can. It's quite a subject, and you're going to have to see, and I'm going to have to see, if I can believe my own Bible, if you can believe your own Bible, and then we'll know exactly what's going to happen. We will know then what is going to happen. Now, Colossians was written about 59 to 61 A.D., and in about 30 years after that, the Apostle John wrote the book of Revelation, and he actually took those events in Colossians and wrote a mighty prophecy, a major prophecy about those same Laodiceans and what they would do in the end time. In other words, those in the first century was only a type of what's going to happen in the last century. If you have a Laodicean attitude in the first century, well, you know it's the same attitude in the last century. If it's Laodicean, they're lukewarm about God. They can't really get stirred up about God. They can't really get on fire for the second coming of Jesus Christ and the work of God to prepare for that. They just can't get stirred. And that's a huge, huge tragedy. It's all that what happened in the first century is just a type of what is going to happen in this end time. Only a type. Now, what they went through was somewhat of a dress rehearsal for what's going to happen in the end time, but because Colossians is tied into the book of Revelation, that makes Colossians, that book of Colossians, a prophetic book. And what a prophetic book it is. I want to get into some of that with you. We need to understand this book, but these people rebelled against God. They threw God's truth to the ground and temporarily destroyed the work of God, but God raised it back up through a little elect who were willing to war and battle and fight against those Laodicean revolutionaries against God. That's what they were. And 95% of God's people turned away from God. Notice Colossians 2 and verse 1. For I would that you knew what great conflict I have for you. Paul is in jail going through all kinds of trials for them, not for himself. And yet many of his critics thought he was trying to get from them. But he says, what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea. See, he's talking about the Laodiceans here. And for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. See, the Laodiceans were there along with the Colossians. And then it goes on in verse 17 and talks about Archippus, a man. He was, you can and say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord, that you fulfill it. Now, most commentaries will tell you they think this is the Laodicean leader. And here he was given a public warning to beware that he stayed with God's truth. And again, you see, even in the first century, they focused on a man. Here was a man leading the rebellion. You see that so often in the scriptures, and yet how many people get to know the Bible and know God well enough just to believe what it says? If there was a man then you can expect a man in this end time and then another man, just exactly the way God says. And I mean, that gets about so specific that it ought to just about strike us like a ball bat in the head as far as the impact is concerned. We need to understand. Here is Archippus. It said in Philemon 2 that he was a fellow soldier with Paul. But here, he turned away from Paul and rebelled against Paul and became a traitor. That does happen in God's church. It certainly does. Notice what Unger's Bible Dictionary says about this. The Laodicean condition describes the spiritual lukewarmness and worldliness that will prevail in the professing church of Christ. They're not really the church of Christ as far as Christ living in them and doing His work. They're not that. They're lukewarm. But even this dictionary understands that this professing church of Christ at the end of the age, they can see that that first century Laodicean church that Colossians talks about is really a prophecy about the end of the age, because the Laodiceans are on the scene again in the last century. Now, they see that it's a sign. They don't know it's a sign, but the dictionary sees that this is a sign. But God tells us it is a sign of the imminent return of His Son to rule this world. What could ever compare with that? What could compare with that? Well, let's read Colossians 2 and verse 4. Paul warns against being led away by a man. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. See, enticing, really scholarly, educated people with words. They know how to use words. They don't know how to submit to God, but they know how to use words.